Good morning, Rob. This is follow-up to the main video, how to evolve vowel harmony systems. If you haven't already seen that video, go check it out. Otherwise, none of this is going to make any sense whatsoever. To be honest, I still don't get how to evolve vowel harmony systems. Is it enough to just add an umlaut sound change, or do you need to repeat it several times? How does it become root controlled later on? Also, what about affixes that aren't affected by vowel harmony? Okay, so let's go through this in a little more detail in this video. As per the main video, you need to have a modern set. In this case, for the sake of simplicity, let's say a, e, u, and you need to have a proto set. Again, for the sake of simplicity, I'll say it's just the exact same inventory in the proto lang. And we need to get from the proto lang to the modern lang via a series of harmony friendly changes. A series being a key word there. You want to do lots and lots of harmony friendly sound changes. And the key point here is to try and create a like critical mass of words and roots, etc., that are in harmony, such that you, the conlanger, can justifiably say that, you know what, harmony just exists in this language. Let's see that play out. So in the proto-lang, we have a whole bunch of single syllable words and roots, etc. These are all definitionally in harmony. Ace, no work needed here. But when we have words and roots that are more than one syllable, some of them will kind of naturally be in harmony, but most probably won't. So we need to bring in our harmony friendly changes. So let's say we're going for back harmony. So we need to do lots of fronting and lots of backing. So let's do some fronting. Umlaut. Every time an E shows up, the vowel in the previous syllable becomes a front vowel. Cool, so now we have some more words that are all in harmony. Let's maybe also say that in the vicinity of palatal consonants, vowels front. So we have even more words that are in harmony. Now let's do some backing. So let's do a mutation, which is like umlaut, except that when you have a low vowel, the vowel in the previous syllable lowers or backs. So again, we have more words in harmony. Then we can do a thing like with the back consonants from the main video, and we have more words in harmony. And once you hit a critical mass of words, roots, etc., being all front or all back, in this case, you're justified in saying that harmony can just take hold. The idea being that the speakers kind of grok what's going on. They kind of subconsciously understand that the majority of the time when speaking this language, their mouths need to be in the one position, either all front or all back. So they kind of just get that and apply it across the board. And hey presto, vowel harmony. So again, step one, modern lang, proto lang. Step two, get from proto lang to modern lang via harmony enforcing changes. Step three, get to a critical mass of words, roots, etc., that are all in harmony. Step four, vowel harmony. Now, I guess you could technically go through and exhaustively create changes for each and every possible case, but that's really cumbersome. So I think this kind of get it to a critical mass thing is a good balance of like realism and practicality. Anyway, you had some other questions. How does it become root controlled? I think you can just say it's root controlled because the root is kind of the important part of the utterance. So just stating root control is a-okay in my book. And for affixes that aren't affected by harmony, those will be affixes that have neutral vowels in them. Transparent vowels, blockers, hybrids, trojans, etc. See main video. I hope that made sense. Again, the key is just many sound changes, not just one instance of umlaut, but lots and lots of them. Make that critical mass. What determines whether a vowel is dominant or recessive in a dominant recessive harmony system? It sounds like quite an interesting type of system. It is for sure really interesting. It is, however, rare, and I would advocate not going down that route. The expected behavior is word domain root control, and I would encourage people to stick with that. But to answer your question, I don't know. I had looked through some of my sources that I used for the main video, and I couldn't find anything definitive with regards to what makes a feature dominant or recessive, or which features are more likely to be dominant or recessive. The impression I get, but I could be wrong, is that it kind of is up to you. Like, there's languages that have plus ATR as a dominant feature, but there are also languages that have minus ATR as a dominant feature. So I suspect you can kind of do what you want. Also, as far as I can tell, dominant recessive systems tend to crop up in ATR harmony systems. I've not read anything about dominant recessive back harmony systems, for example. So I could be wrong on that, but it appears to me that there's a correlation there. Just something to be aware of. There's also something called parasitic harmony, where whether or not a segment can be the target of a harmony depends on the similarity of the target and the trigger before the assimilation. Yes, indeed, nothing much to say here on my end, just want to put it on screen so people know about this. Vowel length harmony? Vowel length harmony is not a thing. If you're looking for sort of more out of the box harmony systems, check out rhotic harmony. It's immensely rare. And it's this idea where if there's a rhotic vowel in a root, affix vowels must also be rhotic. It's cool, it's really rare. Go for it if you want, but I suggest sticking to the big four mentioned in the main video. Nice video, however, a couple of comments. You missed out nasal harmony as attested in Guarani. It's one of my favorite harmony types and a really good example of how vowel harmony systems interact with consonant harmony systems. And for this very reason, I didn't include nasal harmony along with like retroflex harmony because it's not vowel harmony, it's vowel consonant harmony, which is a related though separate thing and it'll get its own video at some stage. You don't really talk about suffix controlled harmony, which is a shame given how common it has been in the development of most Western European languages. The classic example is, I guess, Germanic umlaut, which you kind of refer to in passing, but don't highlight as itself being a species of vowel harmony. So I brought this up in the previous follow-up video, I think, but I'm going to reiterate again here. Umlaut is not vowel harmony. Umlaut is an assimilatory thing and vowel harmony is an assimilatory thing. So there can be some confusion, but the two are related, but they are not the same. Now, this is the third or fourth time I've tried to record this bit and I've just not been happy with the way I've explained it. So I've decided what I'm going to do is I'm just going to read some quotes from some of the source material I was reading in making the main video to hopefully demonstrate that this is a position that linguists hold. This umlaut is not vowel harmony. Quotes come from Vowel Harmony and Correspondence Theory by Martin Krema, Chapter 1.5, Dominance, Morphological Control, and Umlaut. Quote, even though affix control is extremely rare, the pattern is quite robust in Fula. So drop that in there to demonstrate that true affix-controlled harmony, and by extension suffix-controlled harmony, is really rare. It's not common. And I highly, highly recommend people just stay clear of it. Word domain, root control, that's where you want to be. Quote, a more widespread pattern where root vowels depend on the quality of affix vowels is umlaut, which can be found in Veneto Italian, for instance. The process affects only the stressed vowel preceding the affix. From this fact, it must be concluded this is an instance of parasitic licensing rather than vowel harmony. There's an explicit statement of vowel harmony and umlaut are different things. Kramer goes on for a bit with more examples and then says, quote, I regard such cases not as instances of vowel harmony but as metaphony, whatever, or umlaut, which should be treated differently from harmony, which is obviously done in the analysis in Walker 2001. So here we have multiple linguists getting on board on this umlaut is not vowel harmony train. Quote, a second argument for treating vowel harmony and affix-induced umlaut as different phenomena comes from the fact that umlaut often causes the realization of a feature specification in the target which is not present in the trigger. Vowel harmony does not add a feature specification, it extends or copies a present feature specification, while umlaut can add a feature. The example Kramer gives is from Icelandic. If you have a word like tala and the suffix um, they come together and make tölum. That ö vowel has features not present in the triggering umlaut vowel. Now, obviously, I'm leaving out a whole bunch of context here because they're just random quotes from the chapter. So I'd encourage you to pick up a copy of Vowel Harmony and Correspondence Theory and then you can get the full context of all these quotes. The way I think about it in a sort of non-linguisticsy way is that umlaut is a local thing. It happens on a very small scale, whereas harmony happens on a very broad scale. Like it affects large scale structures, umlaut only affects smaller scale structures. And they're related in the sense that if you have lots of these smaller scale changes happening, you can produce a large scale harmony system. But on their own, each of these smaller changes aren't harmony. They're just assimilation between vowels. I hope that makes sense. I fear I may not have explained that very well. Oh, and I'm not just being pedantic or putting you on blast here. I think it's an important distinction to make because we need to have a way of effectively talking about what languages are doing. And if we call the Germanic umlaut harmony, then like so many languages have harmony and we'd have no way to distinguish like what Turkish and Finnish are doing, which are clearly very, very, very different beasts. So I think it's important to make a distinction there. Anyways, that was that. I hope you enjoyed. I hope I cleared up some things where clearing up may have been needed. Thank you so much for watching this video and thank you so much for watching the main video. Special thanks go out to all the patrons, in particular, Lycan, Johan Spadka, Oliver Reed, Spencer Brownlee, Alexander Roper, Andrew P. Shahale, John Huir, Rip the Passe, and World Anvil. Until next time, Edgar out.